Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Bismillahi ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillahi nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nasta'hdihi wa nasta'afiruh. Wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyati a'malina. Man yahdihillahu fahuwa al-muhtadi wa man yudlil fala hadiyalah. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. Dear brothers, in the last few sessions in our topic introduction to the science of the hadith, we mentioned the teacher and the student. The teacher delivers ada, and the student receives, and this is, we call it, tahammul. And this series goes on. The student become a teacher, and next generation also, the teachers become the students of that generation will become teachers, and so on. Today, inshallah, we will talk about the etiquette of the teacher and the students when they handle the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Those etiquettes been a reflection of the amount or the degree or the extent of the love of al-sahaba and al-tabi'een and tabi'i al-tabi'een all the way to our generation who deal with the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the amount of love to our Prophet, the care they gave the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is unparalleled. The closest I can find in the worldly matter or the material world is how people handle the diamonds. With that degree, we see how the Prophet, the Muhaddithin has to care of the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When we studied Imam Malik ibn Anas, we have shown how his majlis, his halaqa, his appearance, his way of dressing, all of this reflects a deeper love and respect to the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So some of the etiquettes, I'm mentioning this just to reflect how much they cared about the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The etiquette of al-muhaddith, a teacher or a student, both of them will become later on in exchangeable places. The scholars has deduced these behaviors from their teachers and so on, all the way to the Sahaba al-Kiram, and they put it in an order. And the first characteristic of al-muhaddith is his intention. This intention is pure, sincere, for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and love of his Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the love of the deen of Islam and love of the Quran and the Sunnah. So the intention is never to be a great person or a scholar or a professor or to show off, and you don't find this in any of those great muhaddithin, and they are numbered in hundreds and thousands. All of them are very keen on the issue of an-niyyah, intention. إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ. The second one, the teacher, his main interest is the spread of the word of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they would sacrifice their lives in that endeavor. They're not doing this to make money or as a profession. They are rewarded for their efforts. Most of those muhaddithin in the first 300 years, they are entrepreneurs. They had businesses. and they make their living outside this enterprise, this endeavor. So their interest is the spread of the word of Islam, the spread the word of Quran and the Hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and of course seeking the ajr, the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nothing else. And receiving the, or being included in the dua of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he said, نَضَّرَ اللَّهُ وَجْهَ امْرِئٍ. So it is anyone who carried the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet has prayed for him, for his face to be enlightened and glorified. The third etiquette, the student would not become a teacher or muhaddith in the presence of somebody who is older than him or more knowledgeable than him. So there is here an etiquette of respect for the teachers and for those who knows better. And to teach and explain the hadith, it doesn't matter how time it takes, to those who ask questions. And he would not hold any information from anyone who asks about a hadith, even if he knows that person who is asking, his niyyah is not for learning, he probably has other intentions. And to have halaqas to dictate the hadith and teach them the depth and the all aspects of the meaning of the hadith. Some of the attires and etiquettes also, they mentioned that they should, before coming to give hadith or teach hadith, to have ghusl, to take a shower, and to have perfume, and to comb his hair and beard, and to dress nicely, and knowing that what he's dealing now is with the words of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's not an ordinary words. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a human, but is not an ordinary human. None of us has received the praise from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wa innaka la'ala khuluqin azim. He's apart. He's with the prophets and with the angels. This is a quality of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The hadith should be done in an environment of respect and reverence and quietness and serenity. And the whole of the people who are listening and learning and teaching should be sitting down quietly. You remember when we mentioned one of the imams, which he did not take the hadith because it was so crowded and he was standing. It's disrespect. So he stopped writing, and because just the environment wasn't right. So we need to be very keen. The teacher should talk to all the students. He would not prefer or have a preference to one of them. And of course, like any other talk, it should start and end by the traditional way of thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, alhamdulillah, and also the as-salah ala Sayyidina Muhammad. Also, he should know his audience. If you have an elementary school audience, you don't start talking about the theory of relativity. You're really doing disfavor to those students. They wouldn't understand. So you need to know your audience. If they are simple people, common people, you teach them the ahadith, which is very simple, very common, resonate with your fitrah, your intuition, with the things which all of us we know. You don't go to details of the aqidah and issues which is so complicated even for philosophers. You don't talk about this. With all the seriousness, it doesn't mean that you don't be cheerful or sometime, you know, have some stories and some light material. So the muhaddith need to do so. The age of the teacher, there is no, some people require them to be 30 or 40 or 50, but this is arbitration. There is no age limits for the teachers as long as he is qualified, certified. Not every PhD gets his PhD at age 30. I know some people got their PhD at 22, like Brother Nazir. He was a PhD, he was a doctor at age 22. So as long as he has the qualification and the certification, it doesn't matter how young he is. We know Imam Shafi'i sat down for tahdith when he was, or ifta, when he was very young. There's a lot more. Al-Khatib al-Baghdadi, and he is a very fascinating figure. He had a book in every topic you think of. So he had a book about al-jami' li-akhlaq al-rawi wa adab al-sami'. He has a book about the etiquette of the teacher and the student of the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Also another scholar, Ibn Abdul Burr, has a book, Jami' Bayan al-Ilmi wa Fadlih. As far as the student, of course, like the teacher, he needs to have the pure intention, the learn, the knowledge for the same reasons we mentioned, pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So an-niyyah is very important, and al-ikhlas, sincerity, is very important. And he would do that for the same purpose, to propagate the knowledge of Islam. It's not to find a job or a position. We have mentioned all those scholars, they had a job outside the Islam or the teaching of Quran and Sunnah and Hadith. Most of them were merchants or whatever, they have jobs. So the student should not learn this to attract some of the worldly benefit. And very important point, you apply what you learn on yourself. And this is true in every aspect of our life. What's the benefit of you learn something like going through that street is wrong and you still go through it, you know? So you have to apply what you know in your life. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لِمَ تَقُولُونَ مَا لَا تَفْعَلُونَ. This is very much hated, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, disgusted. كَبُرَ مَقْتًا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَن تَقُولُوا مَا لَا تَفْعَلُونَ. So the student should apply the hadith as in the Quran. You remember Ibn Umar, he said, we used to take 10 ayah and disappear 3 months to implement this ayah in ourselves. And the same thing with the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Whatever you learn, you have to apply it in yourself. And for the student, he always has to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the success and to be on the right path and to make it easy for him to memorize and excel in the science. And of course, you cannot be part-time. You know, it's nice to learn, expand your knowledge, but it has to be total dedication. For those are the students who want to become muhaddith and so on, it's a full-time endeavor. I mean, it's not half an hour a day or so. Of the etiquette also, to have the respect to the teachers and to deliver or teach those who are lesser than him the hadith. And also he should not have any arrogance or any shyness of asking questions, because asking questions is very important. Also to go to different sources to learn from everyone what he excelled in. Also of sama' al-hadith implies you need to understand it in the light of the Quran al-Kareem, and to have knowledge of it in depth and study all its aspects. You know, Imam Shafi'i used to, from one hadith, which is few words, deduce 80 verdicts, or 90, or 100. So there is, this is jewels, you know, those are diamonds. And diamonds don't have one facet. You know, they have hundreds of facets. They reflect the light in every direction. And that's why it has the glittering. Of course, for anyone who wants to study the hadith, he needs to study the major books, which we have mentioned many, many times, like Bukhari, Muslim, Tirmidhi, Abu Dawud, and Nasa'i, and so on. Also, we need to understand the science of al-jarh wa al-ta'dil. And there are many, many books which dwell on this. Now we are going to move on to study the conditions of al-rawi, the rawi of the hadith, the one who is delivering the hadith, if it's a teacher, and from the Sahaba down to the time of the great scholars who wrote down the hadith in textbooks. And what they require. By the way, this is a science called al-jarh wa al-ta'dil. It's non-existing outside Islam, and nowadays we see it in who is who and so on in a very superficial way. This is, goes in depth to know every person in his life. So the condition of al-rawi, the ones who is going to be accepted, the scholars mentioned to be reached puberty and the age of differentiation, tamiz, and to have the rational faculty, al-aql, to be rational, to be stable, and adapt, to be sharp in his memorization, sharp in his understanding, and sharp in recollecting the, recalling the evidence and so on, like the incident we mentioned about Imam Bukhari. When he visited Baghdad, they wanted to test his dhabt, and they gave him like 10 hadith with 10, they mixed them up with the different sanad, and Imam Bukhari listened to them, and after they finished, he repeated what they said, and he corrected everyone to the point. So this is dhabt. To give you an example, a few in Ramadan, in Taraweeh, when you listen to the Shaykh in Haram, he's reading Quran, those are dhabit. You find them firing the words of the Quran without hesitation, without any mistake. While if we attend our masajid here in Atlanta, you find most of the imams need for somebody to correct them or remind them of the beginning of the ayah, or sometimes they omit some ayahs. So this is su dabt. That one is dabit. He is really very sharp and very confident and competent in his memorization. So this is a dabt, and it's very important, because this dabt, as when we come to hadith sahih and hasan and all those classes of the hadith, we know the difference between al-sahih and hasan is this issue of dabt. The hasan, one of the narrators, is not as sharp. You know, he might depend on his books or notebooks or something to remember. So it goes immediately less than the optimal. And al-adala and al-islam, it's of course, we don't accept an orientalist telling us about hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He has to be a Muslim, he has to be adil. And what is adala means, this is something we will talk about it, inshallah. So the condition of al-aql, the scholar said he has to reach the age of puberty and tamiz, and where he can receive the hadith and can teach the hadith as a teacher and student, as a student and teacher. So issue of al-aql, rationality, or to be rational, includes puberty and to reach the tamyiz, the age of differentiating between wrong and right. And you know, nowadays we have age of marriage, age of driving, all of this touches on this issue of tamyiz, to know the wrong of, from the right. Though you are reach puberty and you know, you think yourself become a mature person. But the scholars noticed that many of the Sahaba had learned or listened from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam when they were very young. We know of them, Anas ibn Malik. He served the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a young kid for 10 years. Abdullah ibn Abbas, he was his, you know, the greatest interpreter of the Quran. When Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam died, he was like 14 years of age, so he was very young. The same thing, Abu Sa'id al-Khidri and Mahmud ibn Rabi'a, all of these were, Mahmud ibn Rabi'a was 5 years of age when the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam died, you know. So this listening to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam doesn't matter how age, but to teach, this is where the issue. And the scholar said 15 years or 13 years, and Al-Khatib al-Baghdadi gave the age of a tamyiz for teaching or telling what he has heard. As far as al-adala, this is an issue related for you to be perfect, to be a gentleman, to be honest, to have righteousness and wara', fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in appearance, nobody has any criticism of your behavior. This is al-adl. So it has to be straight in all the deen conditions or issues, and to be free of any flaws like fisq or ideas, ahl al-ahwa wal bid'ah, and to be a perfect person. Do not have any of what we call khawarim al-murua, perfect gentleman. This is a Muslim concept. Europe and the barbarians never exposed to this till they met the Muslims in the Crusaders and Spain and Sicily. The issue of the gentleman. This is al-muru'ah. If you read the books about al-muru'ah and you read about Ma'an ibn Zaida, I mean, this those personalities, you would be amazed how they conducted themselves. So has to be free of any defects. We call them khawarim al-muru'ah. And Imam Khatib al-Baghdadi, define the adil, the one who knows his fara'id and he practices it, and he would avoid what's been prohibited to do, and like fawahish and all of this, and to be dedicated to honesty and truth in all his statements and action, and in his manners and behaviors, would avoid any flaws, any behaviors which is not really good. And I will mention some of them, because with these criterias, we flunk. All of us, we will flunk. And one of those khawarim al-murua, if you eat a sandwich walking, you know, like you go to Subway and you buy a sandwich and you eat it on the street. This is of khawarim al-murua. If Imam Bukhari is seeing you, he wouldn't take your hadith. So not, you know, many things are like if you play chess. One time, one of those great muhaddithin went to knock on the door of somebody who has a hadith, and he heard music. doesn't mean he was playing, maybe his wife or his daughter. When he heard that, he went back. So those khawar, I know this is tashaddud or very strict criteria, but it was a must in the first 300 years. After that, when the knowledge has been sealed, documented, and the best way of transmission of the hadith of the Prophet was al-wijada, which means to read in the books, the requirements has been eased off. And this is what Khatib Baghdadi mentioning and many other scholars. But this is, was at the level of Sahaba, al-tabi'in, tabi'at tabi'in, tabi'at tabi'at tabi'in, the first 350 or 400 years, those strict rules was applied. And thank God they have done that. We know our deen is crystal clear, so pure. We know for sure what Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has uttered. This is our deen. No doubts, no question asked. If you believe or don't believe, that's another issue. It's a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah in the Quran told them, it's not your business. To believe or not believe, that's up to me. So, but what we know for everyone who is thinking rationally, Al-Quran and the Sunnah is a perfect, exactly as been uttered by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No doubt. We know what Islam is all about. We know what Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught and what he wants us to do. Of worshiping Allah, doing ibadat, and being good to our parents, to our wife, family, children, neighbors, etc., etc. All of these are been documented. So the adil, if he's somebody not known, he required to be adil, to be identified by a person. So somebody has to give him tazkiyah, like a letter of recommendation. But the tazkiyah, it's like shahada. It's not like a letter of recommendation. It's testimony that this man is adil. And of course, the one who is given the testimony, he had to be adil himself. But if somebody like Einstein, you don't need a high school mathematics teacher to give a recommendation or testimony that Einstein knows mathematics. You know, he's well known. I mean, it's obviously he knows math if he came up with the theory of relativity. So the great scholars like Imam Malik and Shafi'i and Ahmed, and they don't need a letter of tazkiyah or letter of, because their statue is so overwhelming. All of them know they are adil. As far as the muru'ah, Imam al-Khatib al-Baghdadi has mentioned the definition of it, depending on a hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The one who treat people and does not transgress against them, من عامل الناس فلم يظلمهم وحدثهم فلم يكذبهم, and when he talk, he does not lie or put any lies in his words, ووعدهم فلم يخلفهم, and when he promised, he fulfilled his promise. If somebody that way, he is a adil. As far as the testimony coming from a person, that person cannot, you know, do that without knowing the person, you know. And to know somebody, it's not enough to know his name and that I saw him in the masjid at Zuhr prayer. You really have to deal with him. As an incident, my brother Bilal knows it very well. Umar ibn al-Khattab, radiallahu anhu, he was asking about somebody, and one of the people raised his hand, yes, I know him. And he told him, this is a good person. So Umar ibn al-Khattab, and you know he's inquisitive, he told him, how do you know him? Is he honest? Is he fair? Is he your neighbor, You see him at night and day, and you see him when he enters his house and when he leaves his house. He told him no. Then he told him, did you deal with him with money, with dollars and cents? Which an issue everyone flunk when it comes to money. And it is indication of the degree of fear of Allah and the wara. He told him no. Told him, did you go with him on a trip, on a journey, where you can see the akhlaq, the conduct and behavior of people, if they are lazy or they are helpful? He told him no. And he told him, then sir, you don't know him. Go and find somebody who knows him. So that's very interesting. So this is, everyone is innocent till you prove otherwise. So al-adl is when you say somebody is crystal clear, is pure. So, and they don't go and in detail to see the aspect of this adl, if he's, you know, at his home, if he's making tahajjud or so. It's enough, the appearance and so on. While the opposite in al-jarh, when there's flaws or defects in that person, you need to identify it. So in the jarh, it is, and here there is legal issues. You cannot say somebody is so-and-so because might be violating his human rights or slandering him, or, you know. So you have to really be very very accurate and very sure that this man has done fisq, or he follows some of the ideas which is destructive and of their whim and desires and so on. So all of this which bring him down from adala to al-jarh. And as we have said, this first 300-400, they were very keen on this issue of jarh. And few things we nowadays take it for nothing, you know, they would consider it, it brings the purity of the person. And again, all these strict rules is not to make things difficult as much as it is to guarantee and secure that the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam being transmitted by the best of the people to the best of the people in an unparalleled way in the history of mankind in disseminating news or information. We haven't seen this anywhere else. Among historians, philosophers, even nowadays the journalists and so on, a lot of fabrication, half-truths, omitting things and emphasizing on things. You are more like in those caricatures which you know, make things big or small, depends on your whim and desires. And of course, that comes out of also knowing that deen is the most precious thing in our life, more important than life itself, that you cannot take it from anyone. Has to be sure this is deen. Ibn Umar narrates in hadith, which they say it is marfu', that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him, Abdullah ibn Umar told him, Yabna Umar, deenuka, deenuka, innama huwa lahmuka wa damuk, fanzur amman ta'khud. Oh, Ibn Umar, your deen is yourself, your flesh and blood. So you be keen and careful from where do you take your deen. Another statement similar came from Muhammad ibn Sirin, one of the great tabi'een. And he was, I think he was a student of Anas ibn Malik. When he said, "Inna hadha al-amri deen, fanzuru amman ta'khudhu deenakum." So if we are 100% sure that this is what Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said or ordered us to do in the Quran, the Sunnah, we let it aside, unless we are sure that this is our deen. And in the hadith of Abdullah ibn Umar, فَانْظُرْ عَمَّنْ تَأْخُذْ خُذْ عَنِ الَّذِينَ اسْتَقَامُوا. Take your deen from those who are straight, and do not take your deen from those who went astray. The scholars had made a kind of scales of the levels of al-jarh. Not all the jarh are equal. So it's starting from the udul, as-sahaba, then those who are the most trusted, and they use some terms like thiqa or thiqa hafiz. The third level, mutqin or thabt, then saduq, or he's okay, la ba'sa bih. Then saduq sayy al-hufz, or he's not known to give hadith except the few, or then comes mastur or majhul al-hal, then da'if, then majhul, then those who were in the business of lying for a purpose, those are called muttaham, is accused of fabricating or saying falsehood. So the scholars had several scales, but this is the scale which is Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani had used in the levels of jarh. And all of these are very important, because when you reach the lower levels, and any person in that level, and he is in the chain of narration, the hadith become immediately daif, and we don't take it. So the hadith has to be like in the sahih, and we'll come to it next week, inshallah, when we'll talk about the classes of the hadith, has to be, in the chain is flawless. Adil, 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 all of them, without interruption in the chain, and other conditions, inshallah, we'll talk about it. As far as the Shart al-Islam, at the time of the incident, if it happens and he wasn't a Muslim, that's fine. But when he teaches that incident, he has to be a Muslim. Like what happened to Jubair ibn Mut'im. Jubair ibn Mut'im was in the army of Quraysh, and he fell prisoner in the Battle of Badr. And the prisoners were kept in the side of the Masjid, and he was still mushrik, non-believer, worshipping idols. And he was listening to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam making Maghrib prayer, and he read Surah At-Tur. So Jubair ibn Mut'im narrated when he became Muslim later on, that when he was not Muslim and he was a prisoner and he was in the Masjid, he heard the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam reading Surah At-Tur. So this is acceptable. So the time of the incident, he wasn't Muslim, but when he narrated the incident, he was a Muslim. So, and he said, as in Sahih Bukhari, when he heard the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam reading Surah At-Tur, it was the first incident or first moment, or the moment when his heart opened up to Islam. وذلك أول ما وقر الإيمان في قلبي. And this is the first time I was in touch with Islam, and my heart opened up when he heard the recitation of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to Surah At-Tur. So I want you to remember these things. شرط العدل العقل والبلوغ والإسلام والضبط. Those are important in the person who is receiving the hadith. And by the till now we are talking about lips to ears. There's no books. Not for the lack of books. We have went through all of this because this is the highest way of transmitting something precious like Al-Quran Al-Kareem by listening and memorizing. And this is the characteristic of Islam in the Quran and the Hadith. Been written down, the time of Muhammad, or sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or this is another issue. And it is a thing which strengthen. But for the early Muslims, the memorization, carrying the knowledge in your heart, in your chest, was the first and the highest class of transmitting the knowledge and disseminating the teaching of Islam. So inshallah, next week we will talk about Aqsam al-Hadith, Hadith al-Sahih and al-Hasan and al-Da'if, and we'll go into the sub-classes. Inshallah, by doing this, we will finish our topic about introduction to the sciences of al-Hadith. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
I just wanted to ask the criteria set by Omar bin Khattab that to know somebody, the criteria he listed, do we really know each other? If we look at the criteria today, I don't think I can.
You're right. Yeah.
Valid question.
Yeah, I don't know.
It's not a criteria, but this is common sense. Yeah. How would I know? How would you know me if you don't be very close?
Even father would not know his son. The boy is born today, the father leave home, and it's your son. You don't know him.
Yeah. Alhamdulillah. We are the brothers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Okay, so he is very proud of us. With all our defects, we are fine. Alhamdulillah. Inshallah, we'll be better. Okay, brothers, we'll see you next week, inshallah. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.